worry, you make it double, don't worry.
Practice being present.
Be happy now.
Part 3.
Don't worry. Be happy. Don't worry, be happy.
Are you in denial? Well, it's not that bad. I mean, I'm okay with it for the most part. Well, you know, I should be over it by now. I mean, look, I'm an adult, for crying out loud. And I've got control of this. I really do. Well, I just can't, you know, I just can't let it bother me. Even though sometimes, you know, it still hurts. Anyway, you just shouldn't focus on the negative. I mean, everybody knows that, right? So, well, so I drink, you know, just to mellow out. You know, one or two drinks a night, maybe a couple of glasses of wine, or sometimes a six-pack. Or I eat something. I mean, you got to eat. Everybody's got to eat, right? And eating always makes me feel better. I know that. And then there's my work. Thank God for that. I mean, I get there early. I leave late sometimes. And sometimes I even work on the weekends. And that's something, you know, that's something I can feel good about. You know, providing for my family. Of course, of course, my wife's not too happy about me staying late, particularly on weekends. Well, and then there's always drugs, you know, drugs, a quick fix. Yeah, you get high, zone out. But I only do that when I'm really, you know, down and out, or just on the weekends, when I really want to feel good. Now, I used to smoke a pack a day, at least, and now it's not too bad. It usually takes me a couple of days at least to go through one pack. Then it's always a kick to hit the casino, or even pick up a few of those scratch cards to see if I can get ahead of the game. Huh? And of course, there's always shopping. I mean, I earn a good salary, so why don't we get new stuff? I mean, every once in a while. And my wife certainly likes to buy things. And the kids, they always need new stuff, too. You know that. And where would I be without my video games? I mean, what better way to work through my angry feelings, right? Right? I mean, I love blasting away those damn aliens that are trying to kill me. Or what about Call of Duty? I mean, I've been playing that one for years, and it just keeps getting better and better, more realistic with every updated version. I tell you, I know I've become a better shooter with a gun just because of that game, really. And then let's face it, huh? The computer, woo, it's a gold mine of things to do, right? Right? Oh, and of course, don't forget about sex. Sex, oh yeah. I mean, well, it's human nature, right? I mean, what a turn on. I mean, if it feels good, then go for it, right? I mean, give each other pleasure in whatever way that works. And then, well, and if your partner says, no, not tonight, there's always pornography. I mean, so you can find whatever you want. In pornography, computer porn is the best, and it's always there. It never says no. I mean, you really have the control. Do you know what I mean? And then there's my exercise. Oh man, exercise. Where would I be without my everyday routine? Weights, stretching, cardio. And sometimes when I go running, I just keep running until I can't jog anymore, and I just collapse on the ground. Same thing for swimming too. I mean, swimming laps. And then there's, well, there's the internet. The internet has it all. I mean, what, Amazon, Facebook, email, text, messaging, download this, download that. I mean, everything. It has it all. Everything and anything you'd ever want is right there at your fingertips. And it's yours for the taking, huh? Or I should say purchasing. And then, well, then there's TV, television, maybe a big screen, little screen. You can watch it on your computer. And once again, you know, whatever you want. I binged my way through Breaking Bad, what, The Sopranos, and how about those three seasons of Fargo? What a series. And then there's what, Netflix, Amazon, Apple TV, Hulu, YouTube. I mean, you can learn on YouTube. You can learn anything you want to on YouTube. You can even learn how to make a bomb. And of course, everyone has to have a hobby: photography, videography, bowling, hiking, aquariums, gardening, mountain climbing. I used to be a mountain climber. I mean, the list of hobbies is endless. You know, some people even spend their free time, all of their free time, with their particular hobby. I had a friend who was, well, he was really into miniature train sets. And he created a whole village, just a little universe of his own, right down there, you know, in the basement. Well, I guess what it comes down to is we're all trying to get our needs met. And to be happy. And let's face it, I'll do anything I can, just not to think about it. Oh yeah, and then you meet someone. And you both look into each other's eyes and you say, "You will meet all of my emotional needs." And it's a done deal, right? What's that? What's codependency, anyways? Letting go of family secrets. Don't tell anyone. Okay, now we're going back to where we left off in part two. Every man and woman has his or her secret sorrows, which the world knows not. And oftentimes we call this man or this woman cold when he or she is only sad. Okay, family members come not only from a biological bond, but also from the bonds of maintained connection, okay? Secrets, however, can enter a family in two different ways. In a way that enhances that connection, that family connection, or in a way that undermines that connection. Well, for many of us, family secrets remain a mystery over the course of our lives, locked behind the closed door we call denial. Comparable, perhaps, to the way Homer Simpson views his life. Just because I don't care doesn't mean I don't understand. Yeah, well, we may remember gossip or exaggerated stories about a peculiar relative and his or her peculiar behavior. We may recall comments with an ethnic or racial slur, or perhaps we witnessed incidents of overt physical, sexual, or covert mental abuse. Now, as the sad refrain from the musical South Pacific warns, you've got to be taught before it's too late, before you are 6 or 7 or 8, to hate all the people your relatives hate. You've got to be carefully taught. I used to be able to sing that. Or perhaps someone whispered something like this into your ear. Whatever you do, don't tell anyone. Well, family secrets of this type generally build walls between people, creating an atmosphere of mistrust, disappointment, and sometimes fear. Now, the most unfortunate outcome, however, happens when a violent or an addictive style of behavior continues unchecked, and it becomes passed down from one generation to the next. Children of addicts are 8 times more likely to develop an addiction. Well, contrary to this regrettable statistic, British writer Alan Watts had this to say about the positive nature of secrecy. This is the real secret of life. To be completely engaged with what you are doing in the here and now. And instead of calling it work, realize that it is play. As the comic strip character Ziggy tells us, we should appreciate the here and now, 'cause it's only here now. Well, as you may be coming aware, the central theme of this presentation is also related to the concept of being present. Yet most of us fail to understand that our persona, or what is often called our ego, keeps telling us that we are already doing fine. We're living in the now, and we're completely content with life, just the way it is. But the sad reality is more like this. We're not living in the here and now. Most of us spend our days lost in a whirlwind of random thoughts, impulses, and worries that clutter up our mind by focusing our attention on ruminations and anxieties from our past, or worries about what might happen to us in the future. Let's face it, we are a culture of distraction. Now, as the old Swedish proverb suggests, worry gives a small thing a big shadow. However, there is another phrase in the East African language of Swahili that presents an opposite view of the concept of worry. Many of you will remember the popular song of the same name by Elton John from the film The Lion King. The name of it is called Hakuna Matata.
Hakuna Matata. It means no worries.
Hakuna Matata. What a wonderful phrase.
Hakuna Matata. Ain't no passing craze.
It means no worries for the rest of your days.
It's our problem-free philosophy.
Hakuna Matata.
Hakuna Matata?
Yeah, it's our motto.
What's the motto?
Nothing. What's the matter with you? You know, kid, these two words will solve all your problems.
That's right. Take Pumbaa, for example. Why, when he was a young warthog.
When I was a young warthog.
very nice.
Thanks.
He found his aroma like a certain appeal. He could clear the savannah after every meal.
I'm a sensitive soul, though I seem thick-skinned. And it hurt that my friends never stood downwind. I know the shame.
He was a shame.
What a change in my name.
Oh, what's your name?
And I got downhearted.
How'd you feel?
Every time that I...
Hey, Pumba, not in front of the kids.
Oh, sorry.
Hakuna Matata, what a wonderful phrase. Hakuna Matata, ain't no passing craze.
It means no worries for the rest of your days.
Yeah, say it, kid.
It's our problem-free philosophy. Hakuna Matata.
The Lion King. So is Elton John, Walt Disney, and the East African language of Swahili suggesting that Hakuna Matata is the answer to life's problems? Huh? Does anyone remember this later sequence in the story from The Lion King?
What was that? The weather. Very peculiar. Don't you think?
Yeah. Looks like the winds are changing.
Change is good.
Yeah, but it's not easy. I know what I have to do, but going back means I'll have to face my past. I've been running from it for so long. Ow! Jeez, what was that for?
It doesn't matter. It's in the past.
Yeah, but it still hurts.
Oh, yes, the past can hurt. But the way I see it, you can either run from it or learn from it. Ah, you see? So what are you going to do?
First, I'm going to take your stick.
No. Not a stick. Hey, where are you going?
I'm going back.
Good. Go on. Get out of here.
Okay. Oh yes, the past can hurt. But the way I see it, you can either run from it or learn from it. Ah yes, good old Rafiki. Yep. The old sage, like any of those other wise old men or women depicted in any hero's journey. So, you know, we're not talking rocket science here, okay? This particular concept has been around since the beginning of time. And, well, if Walt Disney says it's a fact of life, then you know it's got to be true, right? But knowing something about yourself from your past is one thing. But then, acting upon it to resolve that very same problem in your present day life is something entirely different. And the second one is not always quite so easy to pull off. As Greek philosopher Aristotle put it, we are what we repeatedly do. Excellence, then, is not an act, but a habit. Well, regardless of our concept of worrying about the past and how it is related to our present, unless we find a way to confront what most of us would call our family secrets in the present, most of us will live a lifetime of intermittent suffering, sometimes ending in tragedy, as was the case with famed author Ernest Hemingway, who wrote, "Life is a tragedy with a known end." Well, as Hemingway grew older, he struggled with severe pain from old wartime injuries. And to make matters worse, he also suffered from severe mental depression. And then after many earlier attempts, Hemingway finally succeeded in ending his life. Well, how many of you are familiar with this well-known anagram, PTSD, which stands for post-traumatic stress disorder? It's a psychological reaction occurring after a highly stressful event. Now, most of us think of PTSD as a trauma that many war veterans must face upon returning home from battle. Now, witnessing the horrors of war can indeed be overwhelming, as it was first clearly presented in the Oscar-winning film for Best Picture in the 1949 movie called The Best Years of Our Lives. Did any of you see that film by chance? Well, many films since then have presented various examples of the same psychological dilemma. But it isn't just wartime experiences that can trigger PTSD. The same thing can happen to anyone who has suffered and lived through any traumatic situation, like physical violence. "Why, I feel sad. I feel sad because my dad punched my mom in the face. And that's why I'm so sad." Or any other terrifying event, like child abuse. The long-term effects of child abuse include learning disorders or speech deficits, dropping out of school, sexually transmitted diseases, teenage pregnancy, substance abuse, unemployment, crime and violence, brain damage, suicide, depression, anxiety, or low self-esteem. Some people can even experience PTSD from only witnessing a traumatic event, like a school shooting. How many of you have had friends who struggled with similar trauma? Symptoms of PTSD include depression, anxiety attacks, flashbacks, recurrent nightmares, and avoidance of any reminders of the event. Well, another psychological challenge, which we've already taken a brief look at, as you may recall, is the hero's journey. Now, often these kinds of experiences can lead to the road for self-improvement. And according to historian Joseph Campbell, there is what I would call the hero journey, the night sea journey, the hero quest, where the individual is going to bring forth in his life something that was never held before. The hero will bring forth something that was never held before. How many of you remember Tom Junod's question to Mr. Rogers? Do you consider yourself a hero? Okay, heads up. Now, as I told you earlier, this may not be an easy presentation to sit through. You may or you may not learn some things about yourself that you may or may not already know. Here's a photo. It's a photo of my mother who raised three strapping boys, one of whom was me. Now, our mother was also a single parent, as was Fred McMurray in the popular TV show My Three Sons, which ran from 1960 through 1972. Can you believe that? 12 years. Well, apparently, single parenting was a concept most of us could relate to then, well, as it still is today. But unlike Fred McMurray, our mother, like most single parents, was female, not male. And although she and our father were not legally separated, our mother, against her wishes, became the main stay-at-home parent. And so, like many other women, she was an alcoholic. Sadly for all of us, our father's job took him elsewhere during most of the year. He was a yacht captain, believe it or not, a man who geographically distanced himself from his family. And this was, of course, a decision I know he regretted after it became his chosen career. But as most of us realize, many fathers can easily distance themselves from their family by not being emotionally available to them. Hey, Dad, thanks for being emotionally distant enough not to care about me forgetting it was Father's Day. Now, of course, both of our parents, regardless of their shortcomings, had many, you know, wonderful traits. And our mother, she came up with a healthier way of dealing with her frustrations instead of drinking herself to death. She was an avid reader, and she became a virtual encyclopedia of various sayings and quotes and axioms, similar to what I've been putting you through here during these presentations. Well, this was an attempt on her part, I believe, to make sense out of the chaos she had experienced as a child, and then came to realize the very same problems existed later in her own life. Well, she was a very bright lady. And one of her favorite sayings was this: the truth is not always an easy pill to swallow. The pill that everyone wants, truth, but can't seem to swallow it. And of course, most of what the entertainment industry had given us over the years, or has given us over the years, as it continues to do so today, it's not always a depiction of what one would call the truth. Hey, a new study says television can lead to aggressive behavior by children and teenagers. Ah, buzz off, Four Eyes. I'm watching the Dukes. Anybody remember the Dukes of Hazzard? Well, as for the impact that television has had upon us over the years, along with everything else, it's a wonder if any of us have turned out without serious emotional or let alone physical trauma. Another famous quote by good old Carl Jung professes, "You are what you do, not what you say you'll do." Well, like my mother, Carl Jung was a very bright guy, and he died June 6th, 61 at the age of 85. Now, here's an interview he did a few years before he died in which Jung gives his interpretation of death and, more importantly, all of those other influences that come to us even after death. Pay attention. This is pretty fascinating. Jung took the concept of denial to another whole level.
In particular, I remember you said that death is psychologically just as important as birth. And like it, it's an integral part of life. But surely it can't be like birth if it's an end, can it?
Yes, if it's an end. And there we are not quite certain about this end. Because, you know, there are these peculiar faculties of the psyche that it isn't entirely confined to space and time. You can have dreams or visions of the future. You can see round corners and such things. Only ignorance deny these facts. It's quite evident that they do exist and have existed always. Now, these facts show that the psyche, in part at least, is not dependent upon these confinements. And then what? When the psyche is not under that obligation to live in time and space alone, and obviously it doesn't, then to that extent, the psyche is not submitted to those laws. And that means a practical continuation of life, of a sort of psychical existence beyond time and space.
Do you yourself believe that death is probably the end, or do you believe that?
Well, I can't say. You see, the word belief is a difficult thing for me. I don't believe. I must have a reason for a certain hypothesis. Either I know a thing, and when I know it, I don't need to believe it. If I don't allow myself, for instance, to believe a thing just for the sake of believing it. I can't believe it. But when there are sufficient reasons for a certain hypothesis, I shall accept these reasons, naturally. And should say, we have to reckon with the possibility of so-and-so, you know.
Well, now, you've told us that we should regard death as being a goal.
Yes.
And that to shrink away from it is to evade life and
yes.
Make life purposeless.
Yes.
What advice would you give to people in their later life to enable them to do this, when most of them must in fact believe that death is the end of everything? Mm-hmm.
Well, you see, I have treated many old people, and it's quite interesting to watch what the unconscious is doing with the fact that it is apparently threatened with a complete end. It disregards it. Life behaves as if it were going on. And so I think it is better for old people to live on, to look forward to the next day, as if he had to spend centuries. And then he lives properly. But when he is afraid, when he doesn't look forward and he looks back, he petrifies, he gets stiff and he dies before his time. But when he is living on, looking forward to the great adventure that is ahead, then he lives. And that is about what the unconscious is intending to do. Of course, it's quite obvious that we are all going to die, and this is the sad finale of everything. But nevertheless, there is something in us that doesn't believe it, apparently. But this is merely a fact, a psychological fact. Doesn't mean to me that it proves something. It is simply so. For instance, I may not know why we need salt, but we prefer to eat salt too, because you feel better. And so when you think in a certain way, you may feel considerably better. And I think if you think along the lines of nature, then you think properly.
Now, as Jung implied in the previous film clip, when you live your life in accordance with nature, that is the proper way to live. Now, one thing that Jung also discovered was that each of us goes into a dream state of mind while we are asleep, regardless of whether we can remember our dreams or not. Now, in the human psyche, dreams are therefore a natural part of nature. Now, according to Jung, the dream is the small hidden door in the deepest and most intimate sanctum of the soul. Now, after my divorce from my first wife, who was 13 years younger than me, I spent 2 years working with a Jungian analyst in Anchorage, Alaska, which was a 50-mile drive from our home in Wasilla. Now, as some folks choose to do, when chaos within a marriage or a family system rears its ugly head, I wanted to understand the roots of our divorce better. And I wanted to know what had happened to Deb and me over the 7 years that we were together. Now during that time, we became the parents of two beautiful children, a boy and a girl. And I wanted to know why she decided to leave me for another man. My therapist, Dr. Elaine Molchanov, had been in practice for many years. And as a homework assignment, she asked me to begin recording any dreams or nightmares that I could recall in a journal, which I kept beside my bed. Now, at first, it was difficult to remember any of my dreams, but over time, my psyche finally opened up. And then together, we began exploring the outlandish storylines and often bizarre images from my dream state. So every couple of weeks, I would drive back into Anchorage to meet with Dr. Molchanov for an hour-long session, and we would discuss my dreams, content, and also I became familiar with another Jungian practice, which I came to look forward to with each passing session. It was called sand table work. So before talking with her about my dreams, I would spend 10 minutes sitting at a small table in her office, into which I would randomly place an assortment of various toy-like items, small building structures like a house, a variety of tools or weapons, vehicles of transportation, plants, trees, animals, pets, etc. And she told me to sit down, take my time, and make a free association layout of whatever popped into my head, and not to take it all too seriously. So I would choose characters from a wide variety of different types of people, men and women of different ages, sometimes ethnicity, supervillains, superheroes and villains, soldiers, doctors, and many other jobs or professions. And I could also select children in various developmental stages from infancy into teenage years. Now, there were young and middle-aged adults of both sexes, as well as older people. There were gravestones, religious artifacts, and many other unique and sometimes strange items. Well, this particular endeavor gave Elaine the opportunity to view various what we could call themes from my life, which Jung chose to call archetypes. Now, these archetypes are the inherited pattern of thought or symbolic imagery derived from past collective experience. And according to Jung, these archetypes are present in the individual unconscious of each one of us. Well, dream analysis and sand table creations are the tools that most Jungian analysts rely upon to chip away and to give insight into the stark reality of one's family secrets, which are often locked away like dream imagery within the confines of our unconscious mind. So attempting to get to the bottom of a troubled psyche is accomplished by finding the key to these locked doors, which have likely existed for generations within any given family system. So Jungian analysis, as with any other attempt at psychological inquiry, has but one goal: to unlock these closed doors behind which the fears, the anxieties, and the trauma from one's past often remain hidden. Well, Jung was asked, why do dreams speak such an obscure language? And he replied, it does not speak an obscure language. It speaks a forgotten language that we no longer understand. Well, denial, of course, is the defense mechanism that allows victims of abuse or neglect to survive those traumatic events, whether or not they occurred in childhood or later in their adult life. Now, the psyche chooses to block out the pain and also the devastating feelings of shame and often any memory of this suffering can also remain a blank slate. Well, at the same time, that sense of denial will continue to protect us from that trauma we lived through by still keeping us in the dark, often for years later, and sometimes for over a lifetime. Now, the psyche chooses to block out the pain and also the devastating feelings of shame, and often any memory of the suffering can also remain a blank slate. In life, in later life, these feelings of shame, guilt, and pain will begin to rise to the surface of the conscious mind, and the victim comes to relive those feelings, but has no idea from where these feelings come or came. There will be little, if any, memory of the original event, nor where or when or why the trauma happened, nor is there any precise memory of the perpetrator who caused the incident. Well, such abuse may have occurred overtly through violence, rape, or by hitting or physically hurting a child, or a perpetrator may have acted in a covert manner, which is far more challenging to detect. Emotional abuse can be in the form of neglect, ignoring the child's needs and hurtful words, and through suggestion, innuendo, or an unspoken sense of disapproval, a victim will feel that something is wrong with me. And by acting in this manner, the perpetrator feels a sense of control or power, which sadly keeps his victim in a never-ending state of anxiety, low self-esteem. This type of neglect is often one of the most challenging forms of abuse for an analyst to uncover, because the abuse was either verbal or implied through looks of disdain and disapproval. However, becoming aware of the source of such trauma will often set free the victim from that overwhelming feeling of shame. Inheriting addiction. Children of addicts or victims of abuse are 8 times more likely to either develop an addiction or become perpetrators of abuse themselves. And when a victim of abuse is unable to escape from this hall of shame, those issues become nothing more than a sickness passed down from one generation to the next.
When you worry, you make it double, don't worry. Be happy, don't worry, be happy now.
Everyone carries a shadow, and the less it is embodied in the individual's conscious life, the blacker and denser it is. And at all counts, it forms an unconscious snag, thwarting our most well-meant intentions. Okay, practice being